Hi folks, this is David Kwan here, and this video I finally want to just talk about the story, the storytelling of Metal Gear Rising Revengeance. Does it warrant an actual video to talk about the story? Not really. I mean, it is as cheesy as it is incredibly cheesy, it is incredibly ridiculous, but at the same time, it gets really dark and deep and morbid. You know, before I played this game, I actually played, you know, Metal Gear Solid 5, Ground Zeroes, and there were kind of people talking about it online going like, this is the darkest kind of direction where Hideo Kojima has ever gone before, and whatnot, with the series, and there were controversy like, did Kojima kind of treat the subject well or not, or is it too cheesy or whatever, but the subject matter of Ground Zeroes is serious, you know, torture and black sites and all that kind of things. But, you know, playing Rising, I don't know. I think Rising has the way the storytelling is done, the way it treats the elements. But, you know, it gets deep. It gets super morbid. But it's just so cheesy and ridiculous. Like, I think I've uploaded just like the very first beginning part of the game. You know, Raiden is in like this tuxedo talking with the prime minister of this African country, I forgot. But, you know, he's like, Mr. Lightning. The dialogue is cheesiest ever. And there are just action sequences that are just, wow, really, like, there are some cutscenes in Vanquish that just made me go, really? You know, and, of course, Bayonetta, which is I think Bayonetta is its own thing. Like, it's just insane. So Metal Gear Rising is less ridiculous than Bayonetta, which is not saying much, honestly. It's less ridiculous than Bayonetta, but definitely much more ridiculous than Vanquish, which is saying a lot. Because it's ridiculous. Some of the action stuff that just happens in Metal Gear Rising is ridiculous. But it's really hard for me to really grasp the story of Metal Gear Rising because it's supposed to be the aftermath of Metal Gear Solid 4. And for me, Metal Gear Solid 4 ended the series in such a kind of fan service way where I was just like, wow, okay, the story is done. This is the end of pretty much Solid Snake. This is the end, and I you know, this is the culmination of 20 years of Metal Gear experience, Metal Gear Saga, just there. And then Metal Gear Rising is like, oh, now a couple of years after Metal Gear Solid 4, this is what the world is like. I'm just like, really? This is what the world is like? This is fucked up. This is a fucked up world that we're in. There are private military companies again, but they are now cyborgs, and people are. It bothered. This story is. I like where it goes sometimes, but it also really, really bothers me to the fact that this story is tied to the story of Metal Gear Solid 4. And Metal Gear Solid 2, of course. So that is what, as a fan, really, really irks me so much. Just also seeing how Raiden is, his character just does not seem like a character that's supposed to be after Metal Gear Solid 2. Although, I kind of had to kind of readjust. What really helps this game's story is the codec. Go to the pause if you... If you like the lore of Metal Gear Solid and you know, you're interested in the lore of the story, Metal Gear Rising is just gonna, you know, bother the fuck out of you. But the remedy is to, you know, go to the pause menu or the select screen, go to the codec, and just, you know, listen to a lot of the codec conversations that happen. That can kind of help in a lot of ways. I think that the codec conversations are the most Metal Gear part of this game. There are parts, you know, there are times when I played this game, I was like, this is a Metal Gear game, this really, you know, I don't really get that. But I get to the codec conversations, and then there is the, you know, the Russian guy, the general, the Ivan guy, talking about these specific kind of technical jargon of, well, this weapon is blah blah blah, or this jet craft has this many, can fly this many hours per hour, and it's just like, okay, so this It's definitely Metal Gear. And then there's the black dude with dreads, who's kind of stereotypical in his speech. But anyway, the conversations are really interesting. And I just really like that. And the conversation with LQ-84i, the Blade Wolf robot. It's just fantastic stuff because it's artificial intelligence that's learning, that's pretty much learned the human speech or continuing to learn human ways of thinking. And I think I really grew attached to Blade Wolf. I think that's my favorite character in Metal Gear Rising. He helps you out a lot, and he's kind of, he's very humorous in a way. I think he was the best comedic relief in this game when things get really, really dark and crazy. The thing that really irks me is, of course, the portrayal of Raiden's character. He's super naive in the beginning. You know, he's, my sword is a tool of justice, as he's murdering people. And Kevin, you know, tells you from the beginning, the people that you're killing are people. They have cyborg body parts, but they have human brains, they have human emotions. You are killing people. And Raiden's just like, ignores that, saying, but they signed up to be terrorists. So that's okay, because they signed up to be terrorists. But like, this is a world where even Raiden, was it really his choice to become the head of this private security company? No, if you listen to the Coda conversation, actually, you know, he married Rose, or I'm not sure about Mary, but he got with Rose. They had a family, he had a family life with his son and Rose, but he couldn't do it because he needed money. They were living in poverty and whatnot, so he needed a job. He needed to get himself out there. He couldn't work because there was discrimination against his cyborg body. He looked like a monster, so no one would hire him. So the only way he could make a living was to become a crazy-ass, badass soldier. And that's how he came to be the way that he is. So that's Raiden's situation. So somehow, you know, why couldn't he think that other people that he's killing are in a similar predicament? That these people are terrorists, or, you know, doing these, they're not even terrorists. Raiden is not killing terrorists in this game. He's killing private security contractors. People like him, actually. It's just that it happens to be a rival private contracting company. And the company, and behind the scenes, the leaders of this company happen to do some pretty shady shit. Really shady shit. Like, really dark, shady shit. So, you know, it's Raiden doesn't see that. And then by the time Raiden sees it, it's just like, oh shit. And it's funny the moment that happens. I think the moment that happens is really off-putting, because all of a sudden, Jetstream Sam has the power to make people's thoughts go into Raiden's mind. Like, there's no that kind of technology in Metal Gear universe. Like, all of a sudden that's possible. I don't know, was it Jetstream Sam that does it? I don't think so, maybe. I think it was whoever does it. It's one of the leaders of the guy, Senator Armstrong's or whatever. No, he's not even a villain at that point. But yeah, it's just like, oh, so now, you know, Raiden is deeply affected emotionally. Oh no, I've been kind of doing really bad things all this time. And then, you know, he fights the fight scene with Monsoon, and he's just like, alright, you know what? I don't fucking care anymore! I'm Jack the Ripper! And he just, like, pretty much loses all conscience and just become a bloodthirsty murderer who likes to feel pain. It's just like a side of Raiden that just doesn't fit. You know, I'm trying to understand they're trying to add layers to Raiden's character, but it just doesn't work. And the voice acting for Raiden was just gravely, I'm Raiden, Jack the Ripper, those terrorists. You know, that's all that voice acting was. That's the entire voice acting of this game. Raiden as a character is just, he's a badass character in Metal Gear Rising. He does badass things. He does amazing things. And the action is insane. But because I grew to like him as a character in Metal Gear Solid 2, and as Metal Gear Solid 4, you know, you got to see a lot of his vulnerable side. In Metal Gear Solid 4, and the sacrifices that he makes in Metal Gear Solid 4, to return to this character and see this, to me, that is one of the biggest disappointments for that. And also, the downloadable content, the one where the Blade Wolf DLC, you beat the game, and then Sonny is telling the story to Blade Wolf, you know, but Raiden, you know, he is a hero. Like, I have a problem with that statement. Raiden is a hero. Considering all that he does throughout this Metal Gear Rising experience, yeah, I have a really hard time saying that Raiden is a hero. It's really hard. He's totally bloodthirsty guy in this game. He's nuts. It's freaking nuts. I do have to say, one thing that makes this game so dark are the children's brains. I got into the codec conversations, you know, talking about how they rescued all these brains from that laboratory, and what they're gonna do to rehabilitate these brains, and all that is gonna be required. It got heavy in there. Like, wow, that's some deep shit. Like, that's serious, serious morbid shit. Got really dark. I think that part really affected me in such a deep way, like, philosophically. Like, just think about it. You know, these are children's brains, and right now the only way to kind of adjust them to normal society is for them to be, for their virtuality to be simulated in this room. They're by themselves. You know, there's no way for them to have any conversations with anyone, but at least that's better than just the brain. I can't imagine the kind of trauma that would induce on a child's brain. You know, we have solitary confinement, so I might do another video in the future just talking about solitary confinement. The effects on human behavior of solitary confinement is insane. So imagine these kids who are pretty much practically in solitary confinement in virtual reality for God knows for how long. And they have to rehabilitate, you know, with artificial limbs and artificial organs and systems and whatnot. Just, you know, it's heartbreaking that these children were manipulated in this way to become weapons. And even when they are rescued, the rescue is still there and still in pretty much, like I said, this game gets to really, really dark stuff that I would not have, you know, imagined out of such a cheesy, ridiculous game. So many parts of this game is so cheesy and ridiculous that when you get to this stuff, it's easy to dismiss. But then you get deep into it and just like, shit, this stuff is in this game. This is what Metal Gear is about. In fact, although it's just presented in such a way that is so not Metal Gear, it's just, I know, Metal Gear is like the canon games. There's a lot of B-movie aspects to it, but I can kind of see that as, you know, Kojima's homage to B-rated movies. In Metal Gear Rising, it's not an homage, it's not an homage. This is not a respect for a medium that is kind of inspired by. It's just Platinum's going saying, we think this is really cool that this is happening. Just like, that's, I think Platinum Games game making philosophy is, if we think it's cool, it's gonna be in the game. You know, Vanquish was like that. It's just like, oh yeah, this moment where they're in slow motion and they're flying in the air, shooting at each other, twirling in the air, we think that's cool, so we're gonna have a cutscene of that. Just like, okay, what just happened? You know, we're gonna have Raiden, you know, jump from missile to missile to missile and slash a robot, a 50-foot robot in half with his sword, because that is cool. It just happens, you know? And the final boss fight, like, Senator Armstrong, like, seriously? Nanomachines, son. Okay, so nanomachines explain a lot in Metal Gear Solid 4, but to the point that it explains Senator Armstrong's ability in this game is ridiculous. What? What is, I think, the most ridiculous is the DLC, Jetstream Sam's DLC. Again, that boss fight. I think Senator Armstrong boss fight in the Jetstream DLC is worse than the main game. But anyway, I beat it. I just gritted my teeth and I actually beat it to see that ending cutscene. Oh my god! So, spoiler. You know, this whole video is spoiler, but seriously. Jetstream Sam is manages to chop Senator Armstrong's arm off, right? And Senator Armstrong laughs, puts his arm back, and it just reattaches itself because fucking nanomachines. What the fuck? Is that real? Really? Who wrote this shit? What? This is supposed to be the continuation of Metal Gear story. That just, why couldn't it be like, if this is considered canon, it just drives me nuts. I like the deep stuff, although it's so deep, so dark, morbid. But it's when you have stuff like this, it just goes, okay, so Metal Gear is cheesy, but not this. This is just ridiculous, you know. And then the ending monologue by Senator Armstrong is just, so I think what I like about Metal Gear series as a whole is that the villains in this game, they have their own reasons for what they're doing, and their rationale is pretty, it can be compelling, although not always. Metal Gear Solid 3, Bulgan, he's just evil, one-dimensional. But some of the villains in Metal Gear Universe are not, we can't, you know, they have their own complex reasons for doing things. And some of the heroes, you know, they have their complex reasons for doing things. And I think they tried to add that layer onto Senator Armstrong, you know, and thinking, you know, we're going to create this paramilitary contracting company, and it's going to be so powerful and so corrupt that people are going to see that corruption, and we're going to, his plan is to mantle it down so that the world can be peaceful, and there's going to be no PMCs, whatever. That's this kind of convoluted plan for world peace that Jetstream Sam ends up agreeing to be a part of. Because, I don't know. It's just convoluted, ridiculous nonsense. Like, seriously, did you really have to make it this way? I do like some of the premises of this game, though. Like, you know, I just wish there was more chance to get to know each of the six villains. I don't know, I don't remember if it's six, but, you know, the villains, they're really cool character designs, you know, the, Mist, the female character, I forgot her name, damn it, but with the octopus arms and things like that, she's really cool. Monsoon, Sundowner, Jetstream Sam is just such a badass. So my two favorite characters in this game, I think I only like two characters in this game. Everybody else, you know, the game didn't do them justice to represent them, especially Raiden was butchered. Sunny was just kind of brief fan service and doesn't really delve into anything more. Just like, oh, there's Sunny, that's really cool. That's it. Two characters I like in this game are Blade Wolf and Jetstream Sam. I think that's why they got their DLC, because they're badass characters. I really like how culturally sensitive the creators of this game were in creating Jetstream Sam. I think he's Brazilian, right? In this game, but it's just so cool, you know, to have that kind of character in this game. And the moment where you face off against him in the Nevada desert, that has to be, you know, one of the coolest moments in the game. So overall, the story of this game is just really cheesy, ridiculous for the most part. It's nonsensical to know that this belongs in the Metal Gear series storyline is just maddening as a Metal Gear fan. I really wish that wasn't the case. I just wish this is like a parallel alternate universe where this shit doesn't happen. It's just fantasy, like the Metal Gear Acid series. You know, I like Metal Gear Acid's story just because at least I can kind of have that wall where, okay, so Metal Gear Acid's universe is totally different than Metal Gear universe. Whereas Metal Gear Rising is not. It's part of the Metal Gear universe, and that really is frustrating to me. I really like where the codec conversations that happen. And that's, you know, a lot of it is too much technical jargon, but there are some golden gems in there that happens, especially conversations with Blade Wolf. And the conversations about those children's brains, like, seriously, those are the German scientists, conversations with that guy, it gets deep. It gets really philosophical and really dark and morbid, and that's something that, you know, Metal Gear does. You know, I thought it was darker and more morbid than anything I've experienced on Ground Zeroes. So that's one thing. I'm not saying that the more morbid you go, the better the game story is. I'm just saying, you know, I just didn't expect that Uprising, because everything else was so cheesy and corny and ridiculous. Just didn't expect it. But it's there, and I got into it, and it's pretty interesting. But yeah, that's what I gotta say about Metal Gear Rising's story. It's just, it's all over the place. It's a Platinum Games game. I think anytime I play a Platinum Games game, I think I should expect that. God, if they make a Metal Gear Rising 2, I really wish the one thing they do is separate that universe from the Metal Gear universe. Like, it should be a spin-off, like a complete spin-off. But the fact that this is a sequel to Metal Gear Solid 4 story, just... No, why? Why did they do that? Because nanomachines, son. Seriously. Alright, I'm out. Hope you guys enjoyed. Cheers.